At this point, I would like to introduce staff attorney for the ACLU, Rod Motz, who is going to give us a brief overview of what's bringing us here tonight.
Thank you, Lisa. How is everyone this evening? Thank you for joining us. I appreciate that. I know how beautiful it is outside and how tempting it may be to be elsewhere, but this is an important issue, one that the ACLU has been working on for quite some time. As the field director, I'm responsible for doing policy and organizing work around issues, particularly those related to education, because it's a personal passion of mine. And this campaign that we are involved in to address the school-to-prison pipeline is one that I'm deeply invested in, and I hope that as we continue this campaign, we get more folks on board with us. We are involved in this work because the school-to-prison pipeline, I'm assuming you all know what I mean when I say school-to-prison pipeline, because you look like beautiful, smart people, is really about the policies and practices in place that have a disproportionate impact on certain students. Specifically students of color, students from lower socioeconomic backgrounds, LGBT students or students who identify as LGBT, and students with disabilities. So much so that we have launched this special project to look at that, because the impact of these policies and practices is having a larger and larger effect on students in special education for a number of reasons. So just to give you a scope of what has led us here, I'm going to talk briefly about zero tolerance. And that is really a policy of no tolerance whatsoever towards certain behavior that really grew out of this campaign to keep guns out of schools, initiated with the Gun-Free Schools Act of 1994, which mandates that any school that gets federal education dollars have a policy of zero tolerance relative to weapons. Unfortunately, since 1994, as a result of some tragedies like Columbine in 1999, and some policies that says we need to deal with those quote-unquote bad kids more sternly, we have seen policy intended to keep guns out of schools treated with zero tolerance really morph into a philosophy of how we deal with misconduct in schools. And that's why it has a disproportionate impact on certain kids as a result of lack of cultural competency or being comfortable or equipped in some cases. I know we have some educators here in the room tonight, by show of hands, and we have quite a few. And I should have began my remarks by saying I'm the grandson of a retired special education teacher. My grandmother taught blind children, actually, in her career. So I'm incredibly sympathetic to educators, but I understand, as you do, that the way that we conduct discipline in some schools is having unfortunate consequences for too many children. And so our goal is really to increase or improve outcomes as well. So as a result of the spread of zero tolerance, Michigan now, along with another state, a lot of other states have policies that don't necessarily deal with weapons. And we are worse than most states. In fact, there's only one state right now, Texas, that has more included in zero tolerance than we do here in Michigan. And it's having, as I said, grave consequences, particularly for minority children. We have about 1.5 million students in public education in Michigan. About 1.1 million of those students are white. About 280,000 are black. And despite the fact that we have four times as many white students as black students, we literally have more black students, about 60,000, suspended in a given year than white students, about 57,000, out of about 137,000 suspensions overall. That's about 9% of our student population. When it comes to students with disabilities, though, we see anywhere from 16 to 18% of them being suspended, which is, you know, about twice their rate. So it is a huge problem. The numbers are also bad when it comes to being referred to law enforcement or arrested. Special education students, like I said, make up less than 20%, but they make up over 20% when it comes, less than 20% of the population, but over 20% when it comes to referrals to law enforcement and arrest. And when that happens, the odds of kids actually graduating are pretty small. And kids who don't graduate have a hard time, right, thriving in our society. We know that about 68% of our prison population is made up of people who didn't graduate from high school. So students with disabilities who have, you know, a number of challenges to get over, really being pushed into a corner now because of the policies and practices in place in our schools, and that's why we're doing the work that we're doing. So we have a great panel of folks who work on special education-related issues and advocacy-related issues tonight that are going to share some resources with us that we hope that you will help us spread, because this campaign is really about spreading knowledge of what student rights are, but also about spreading knowledge of what resources are available, both to educators as well as to students and parents when there is some sort of disciplinary incident a student's facing. And with that, I'm sorry.
Everybody keeps trying to steal my bio, so they don't want to know, they don't want me to know who they are. So I'll start with Mr. Rod Mott, since he did just speak. As he said, he's the field director for the ACLU of Michigan. He's responsible for cultivating support for ACLU issues and overseeing community organizing and coalition building across Michigan communities. His duties include working with the public sector officials to address policy reforms and needed to protect and preserve civil rights and civil liberties, and helping individuals better advocate for those necessary reforms. The major areas of focus for his work are education, juvenile justice, human rights, and mass incarceration. To his left, we have Kate Malkoff. Kate is a graduate student at the University of Michigan, where she is working towards her master's in social work. She is a board member for the Students' Rights Project, an organization consisting of students in the schools of law and social work. The Student Rights Project trains university students to serve as non-legal advocates, representing children in public K-12 schools who are facing long-term suspension and expulsion. To Kate's left, we have Kenzie Bisbee. I told all of them that I didn't want to mispronounce their names. Kenzie Bisbee. She is an education manager at the Oakland Mediation Center and has been active in the field of mediation, dispute resolution, and crisis intervention for over 15 years. Kenzie has conducted over 180 mediations, conflict resolutions, and bullying prevention trainings for adults and youth working with a diverse group of schools ranging from urban to rural and public to private. She has also mediated hundreds of cases across Arizona, Texas, Ohio, and Michigan involving truancy, family, guardianship, divorce, and community issues. And finally, we have Brad Demms, who is a staff attorney for the Michigan Protection and Advocacy Service Incorporated. His focus is mainly on special education issues, including representing students and their families at IEP meetings, manifestation determination reviews, and due process hearings. Brad graduated from Wayne State University Law School in 2012, and he has extensive experience working with people with disabilities in a variety of contexts. At this point, I'm going to turn it over to our mediator, Karen Tomei. And Karen is an educator with the Bloomfield Hills Public Schools. Yes, I didn't want to mix that up. And also a school board member for the Ferndale Public Schools. So we welcome Karen.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you. So my role tonight is really to make sure that I am connecting you to the information that you came here to seek. So the first thing I want to do is I would like to draw your attention to the center of your tables, where you're going to see that there are some index cards and some pens there. So please do feel free to write questions that you may have on those index cards and bring those up to me. And because I want to make certain that we keep the night rolling and get to as many questions as possible, I will be rather strict on our panelists up here and trying to keep them to 2 minutes or less with most responses. So with each question, I'm going to ask the first person to provide about a 2 minute answer, and then if they could just pass the mic to the left, and I will always come back and get you on the end there and swing the mic on back, okay? But before we start, if I could invite you to please, I know we've already heard from Rod, but if I could ask, maybe Kate here to start by just giving a 1 minute introduction of what it is that your organization does.
Hi everyone, I'm Kate Malikoff and I'm representing the Student Rights Project tonight. So we just talked a little bit about it, but the Student Rights Project brings together law and social work students at the University of Michigan. And we work in partnership with the Student Advocacy Center. And what we do is work as non-legal advocates. We represent students, whether they have a special education need or not, in expulsion and suspension hearings. I believe all of our hearings so far have been solely expulsion hearings. So we get them from the intake, and then we move them through trying to do some mediation with the school. If they have an IEP, we can work with that up to preparing the parents and the student and the community members for the hearing. And then we'll work with them afterwards if they're hoping to move schools or get some help with the school that they're at in terms of changing teachers, that sort of thing.
Good evening. My name is Kinsey Bisbing. Oakland Mediation Center is a nonprofit organization. We are actually one of 18 mediation centers across the state, so we are known as part of the community dispute resolution programs. So like I said, we are one of 18. We service primarily Oakland County. We offer everything from mediation services. So we have the Michigan Special Education Mediation Program, and this provides free mediation and mediation around issues in special education, as well as,
Excuse me, even though you're using your microphone, can you talk loud? It's really difficult.
Is it not?
If I just use my mama voice, is that better? That's not.
Karen was the only one.
So pretend like I'm on American Idol?
There you go.
Okay. So let me start over, and I'll talk fast so I don't use up my time. Oakland Mediation Center is a nonprofit organization, and we provide mediation services. One of those is through the Michigan Special Education Mediation Program, where we also, in addition to mediating issues around special education, we have facilitators that will come and facilitate an IEP meeting or an IFSP meeting. Then we also provide education, where we are teaching people how to communicate, problem solve effectively when they're going through that IEP process, as well as some
for just a second, my other job is to always hold our panelists accountable for the alphabet soup that we tend to use in education. So if you could please define your IEP and other acronyms.
Thank you. And see, I'm trying to go fast, and here we go. So, IEP is an individualized education program, and an IFSP is an individualized family services plan. So, children birth to three are involved in early intervention, and then from 3 to 26, they're involved in general special education. So, that's the difference there. So, thank you for catching me on that one. I know, I have to watch myself with her. So we also do a variety of programming in schools to provide alternatives to zero tolerance as well.
All right, I'm Brad Dems from Michigan Protection and Advocacy Service, and we go by the acronym MPAS, so now you know what that means. MPAS is a private, federally funded, nonprofit organization. We provide protection and advocacy services for people with disabilities, and that can be any kind of disability, whether it's a physical impairment or a mental health issue, and I focus on students' rights issues, special education issues, but really we provide information and referral services to people who call in. That's sort of the first line. People call in, get information and referral. If it's a case that they feel would meet our legal priorities, they refer it to the legal team, which is a smaller section of the organization. We have a few priority areas for special ed issues, including restraint and seclusion occurring in the school setting, transition issues, so students who are about to age out of special education, making sure that the school is providing the right services for them to be successful in the next stage of their life. And then one of the most important ones, and certainly the one that we get the most calls on, is issues of school discipline and push out or segregation of students with disabilities by removing them from the school setting when they have disability-related behavior issues, which is a lot of what we're here to talk about today.
Thank you so much. So our first question, we're going to start with Kate. So what we'd like to know is, what problems are you seeing with discipline or delivery of services for the special education community in the schools that you serve?
So we serve, am I good? We serve really all over southeastern Michigan. So we've been in schools in multiple counties, and I would say one of the biggest issues So we get students once they've already been threatened with expulsion. And one of the biggest issues we find is if a student already has an IEP, it most likely has not been looked at within the past year. More, I think our average right now is that they haven't been evaluated between 2 to 3 years. And the number one thing that we try to do with students who have IEPs is work to see if their behavior is a manifestation of their disability. And without proper evaluation, that's very difficult to do. So a lot of times students will already have reached the expulsion stage, especially if they're younger, because they will have compiled a number of short-term suspensions for behaviors that are really related to their IEP. Maybe they're being disruptive in class, but it might be more related to their ADHD than just being disruptive in class. We have students who the family background hasn't been looked at when making the IEP. We just worked with a student who had PTSD from an early childhood trauma, and that had never been discussed in any of the IEP meetings, and it had a lot to do with her behavior, and we were able to get her classified for an IEP. So I would say the biggest issue is just not keeping that in mind and not getting that evaluation checked every year and having that sort of holistic view when
working as a neutral party. So we don't provide advocacy for families or for the schools, but both of those parties will come to us asking for assistance in addressing some of their concerns. So we can have people asking for a mediation because they are in disagreement about an eligibility for a service. It might be concerns around interpreting the evaluation results. It can be disagreements around transition services and what those should look like. It can be concerns around someone being expelled and a disagreement about if that is a result of their disability. We also have people requesting us to come in and help to facilitate the individualized education program meeting because maybe there's going to be some dominant personalities in the room that people are worried about, or they have a history of unproductive meetings, or there's a lack of trust there, and so we come in for a variety of reasons.
Sure. I'll just add to piggyback off of what Kate was saying. That, you know, it's so important to get good evaluations. That's really the number one thing. That's the gateway to services, and that's really what contextualizes what's going on with a student. So it's just paramount that students are evaluated appropriately, that their issues are being recognized for what they are, and that evaluations are done within the time frames mandated by the law. Every year, the schools are required to have an annual IEP for a student who has an IEP, and then every 3 years they're required to do new comprehensive evaluations. But parents can also request evaluations at any time, and then the school is on a certain timeline to respond to that and to conduct evaluations. So there are plenty of opportunities. Actually, if I could ask, do we have any parents of students with disabilities in the audience? Okay, so yeah, it's just important to know that you... What's that?
Can I make one, I'm an advocate, can I make one comment? Districts do not have to do a comprehensive reevaluation every 3 years. They can reach out to a parent and get the parent to agree that no new evaluation is necessary. And that's happening all over the state.
Thank you. Yes, schools, districts can try to get parents to waive their rights, but it is something that is required. So if a parent waives their right to have the evaluation, then that relieves the school district of their obligation. So.
Eligibility determination is required. The evaluation is not. Sorry.
We get complaints about none of those things being provided, particularly when it comes to evaluation. And sometimes when it comes to the services that they should be entitled to, they're not getting. We get complaints about folks essentially being pushed out of school by being encouraged to disenroll or encouraged to enroll in other districts. And it's happening with increasing frequency. We're noticing that, you know, this push-out phenomenon has really been driven by a number of factors, right? and it's something that we're looking at more intently now, because we see it's not just, you know, an urban problem or a big school problem. It's not just a charter school problem, although the concentration of charter schools, and to some degree, the schools of choice programs are contributing to this. We've actually had a researcher looking at the phenomenon of forest. One of the things that we've seen is that in cities that have higher concentrations of charter schools, there tend to be more of these disciplinary incidents. And so it's more important now than ever that parents and students know what rights they should be expecting, and when people are trying to discourage them from seeking the services that they are entitled to, they know better.
So we're going to let Brad start the next question. And the question is, what would you like to see done differently, and what do you see as being some of the potential impediments in that happening? And feel free to take that from your own lens. So, for example, you with your law may want to look at it from a policy standpoint, or what some of the resource impediments are in schools or things of the sort, okay?
Thank you. I think the thing that's most important, is this good?
I know, I can
see this. So one thing that's so important is to shift the perspective back in terms of what is behavior that is school-related, that's a school-related behavior issue that should be handled in the school setting, rather than something that necessitates the involvement of law enforcement. And how we shift that perspective can be done in a lot of ways through lobbying for policy reform, just getting more community stakeholders involved in understanding the problems that we're facing with school behaviors being sort of looked at as reasons to refer students to law enforcement. Like I said, that a lot of that starts with proper diagnosis of the issues that students are facing. If we don't understand what is actually going on with the student, it's a lot easier to consider them just a bad kid and to kick them out of school and to get law enforcement involved. I think through partnerships with community organizations, the schools can gain a new perspective, maybe a more in-depth perspective than what they may have already. So community mental health organizations that are frequently involved with families, students might have individual therapists through a CMH or through another CMH community mental health, or through another organization, and if the schools are willing to open their doors and open their minds to listening to these people who have another sort of perspective, a separate insight into what's going on with the student, I think that that would be very beneficial for all parties.
Same question. What would you like to see different?
I think policy change is a substantial impediment, because I would like to see this approach differently from both the top down and the bottom up, right? To empower students and parents to know, as I said before, what they are entitled to and what they should expect, and to recognize when they're not getting it. But also, I think, in my opening remarks, I mentioned the fact that zero tolerance is a philosophy now about the way that we discipline children in our schools, and I really think we need to start with changing the law, right? So that we narrow the focus of what we can expel kids for when it comes to mandatory discipline, and then really jumpstart the conversation about our policies overall, so that we're not taking as punitive an approach when it comes to suspensions. And I really think that's those are the first two steps. I think they're substantial. I think they really begin to steer us in the direction we need to go long term.
Yeah, so I would say my answer is twofold, and I want to touch on the zero tolerance policy. I think it has become, we often get students sort of in crisis. They have maybe 2 weeks until the hearing, and we need to work towards getting them a review hearing instead to sort of postpone the whole process. But I was looking through our records yesterday, and we've had about the same amount of students in the past 3 weeks that we had all semester, because it's the end of the school year. Administrators, teachers, schools, they're tired, and the zero tolerance policy is something that is so easy to fall back on to sort of take care of the problem until the next school year. A lot of our cases rely around the word intent and reminding people that students need to have intent, and if they have an IEP, it's often more related to that than their intent. I think the other thing that I just wanted to touch on that I would love to see change is education. It is very difficult to work through the wording of Michigan's law in regards to anything relating to special education. We have sort of a special ed team in the Student Rights Project. They're people who have worked as special ed students, teachers, and now they are law students or social work students. And it can take us hours just to try to read through maybe how to get a student a manifestation hearing. And it's really difficult, and I can't imagine how difficult it is for a parent who's also having a job and kids. So working on getting that education from the start so that we don't have to meet them at crisis time.
Can I just add, while I was at my desk in Detroit today, I literally heard our intake person make 4 referrals to you.
Excited for those emails later.
Can you repeat the question so I make sure I stay on topic?
Absolutely. So the question is, what would you like to see done differently, and what do you see as the impediments, maybe resources or whatever else?
So the key thing that I'd like to see done differently is changing our vocabulary from a versus to a together. You know, we have agencies, we have schools, we have communities, we have students, we have parents, and it's not a case of who's doing the right thing and who's doing the wrong thing, and how do we get people to do, you know, what we want them to do, but more of how do we all work together to really help our children, which, you know, are our future and members of our community. So I think it's changing our language and our frame of mind, and that can be done through, you know, doing prevention programs and thinking first on collaboration versus being adversarial. So more of our frame of mind.
Thanks so much. And I just want to piggyback on one of the things that you were saying. I think that we keep hearing a lot of mention of the zero tolerance policies. How many of you know whether or not the school district you live in has a zero tolerance policy? Are you aware? Okay. If you're not aware whether or not your school district does have such a policy, I encourage you to reach out to your superintendent or your local school board and engage them in that conversation. I know, for example, when I came on the Ferndale School Board, that was one of the first things that I started looking into, and I think that you and I had some conversations, and we have actively looked through our policies to try to make sure that they are not feeding that school-to-prison pipeline. But that's certainly something that you as community members can start engaging in with your school boards and superintendents. So, sorry, as moderator, I'm supposed to be invisible, but I just wanted to chime in with that. So we're going to come back to Rod and start this with you. And this is somewhat visionary. And we're sitting here in a room with, you know, students, parents, educators, concerned residents. And so my question to you is, what would you like to see as far as better involvement from these members? How would you like to see the community, the schools, the educators, even law enforcement, what type of involvement would you like to see that you feel would be better and more positive?
I really think it starts with greater collaboration, realizing that when it comes to students in special education particularly, or other vulnerable children, it really requires all hands on deck, because while it's important that we change policy and practice in school, it's also, I think, essential that we realize that students need support on a number of fronts, including in the home and in the community as well.
I actually think you said it perfectly just now, that it shouldn't be about the versus, it's working together. Every case we have, it's a very adversarial environment in the room, and instead, we could all be working together to understand all the different parts of the child that we're hoping to help, to work towards a better solution in every environment that the student is in.
So often, we look at the intervention side of things, so after something has happened, but there's so much that can be done on the prevention side of things as well. And that's one of the areas that my organization specializes in, where, you know, we work with schools to set up programs, everything from restorative practices to peer mediation to bullying prevention to conflict management, where we're really working to help teach people skills, everywhere from the adults in the building to the students, those skills so that they know how to communicate effectively and manage those situations of you cut in line or, you know, didn't include somebody to play with, so that they can keep practicing those skills in those little moments, so that when the bigger things of life that happen, they are falling back on that skill set that they've already been honing in on.
So we've talked about cooperation a lot and prevention, and you mentioned the word communication, and I think that's where it all really starts for everyone, no matter what your position is, what stake you hold in this struggle. It's important that we all communicate with each other, that we share our ideas, that we share what we're seeing in schools, what we think could be done better. So meetings like this that go on, other informal communications between different people, it's just important to keep the avenues of communication open and to understand that we're all here, mostly all here, certainly everyone here is here for the same goals, and to just keep that in mind and keep working together.
All right, Kenzie, lucky you, we have a question directed at you. So somebody was wondering on your brochure what the meaning of tier one, tier two, and tier three is.
So that is some educator lingo. I know, I apologize. So we have that in there because this brochure is oftentimes shared with educators, and so they're like, oh, I get it. It really comes out of RTI, which is Response to Intervention, and PBIS, which is Positive Behavior Intervention Supports, where they categorize kind of these tiers of interventions. So at the base level, it's kind of like for all students, and then mid-level is for students that are kind of showing different risk factors, and then at the very top level, are students that are already engaged in these troubling behaviors. So it's really kind of how targeted or focused the program is. And the programs that we offer have things built into them to address all of those layers, right? So it addresses everyone and teaching them basic skills, but then there's some more tailored and targeted activities for students that need a little additional assistance.
Okay, so this is the exciting part of the night where it starts coming really to your questions. And if you don't feel like you're hearing your exact question, that's because sometimes it bundles with another question as well. So I do, as moderator, reserve the right to repackage your questions, but hopefully you'll hear your answer in here. One of the audience members is wondering about the issue of parents sometimes not knowing what they don't know. In other words, parents don't know how to be an advocate for their child, and they don't know what they should be advocating for, what the rights are for their students. So how do we improve that communication piece? And since you had started there, I'm going to give you an opportunity to piggyback on what you were saying and continue it to the right this time.
We've all heard the expression, if you see something, say something, right? So if you have a feeling that something's not right with, if a parent feels like something's not right with their child, if they're being removed from school a lot, something's probably wrong. And you talk about when parents don't know that they don't know, and that can be tough, but I think it all goes back to spreading the word about what parents are entitled to. There's a handy little pamphlet here that I saw being passed out, ACLU pamphlet, talking about parental rights and students' rights, and I think that's a really great, small, quick resource that can be passed out, and just continuing to disseminate information to people who are in need of that information is really the best way to do that. And if we keep doing that, eventually we'll get to more people who will get to more people, and you know, it'll spread out from there, ideally.
That was such a great question, because it is such an overwhelming process to get involved in when your child enters into special education. It's like this foreign world that you're not aware of until you're in it, you know? And so, a great question. We get people calling us kind of concerned about that, and, you know, I'm sure that there's something that I'm not, you know, catching here, or I'm just saying, anxious about this meeting that we have coming up, and I want to make sure that it's going in a way where I'm going to have time to ask all of my questions and not feel rushed or whatever it might be. And so we have, like I said, neutral facilitators that go out and help to do that. So their role is to help focus on the conversation and speeding it up when it needs sped up and slowing it down when it needs to slow down, so that people can concentrate not on facilitating the process, but the content, so that parent can focus on asking all those questions and making sure they really understand, and the special education teachers can concentrate on, you know, talking about the items that they need to discuss, and the general ed teacher, you know, likewise, everyone can concentrate on their areas and not get sidetracked with having to manage the conversation. So,
yeah, I think the number one thing I would say, and again, I'm thinking mostly from a discipline background, is just to keep asking questions. One of our most recent cases, I had to call 9 times before I could finally talk to the person that I wanted to talk to get my questions answered. A lot of times in my experience with cases, the people who have the most time to talk to me are not necessarily the people at the school, but the people at the district level. And to know that there are representatives at the district level, I think in almost any school district, who know all of this information and should be able to sit down and work with you through it and help you see if you're missing anything.
And I'll just add, so, I mean, I think Brad made a great point, and we developed that piece, by the way, with the help of MPAS, expressly because we get complaints, as I mentioned, not only from students and parents, but from educators in some instances who are concerned with the treatment of students in special education in their schools, or students who should be getting services who aren't. So I think there's broad recognition that there needs to be more done to address these issues, but what we need now is help in really spreading awareness about what resources are available to folks. And I mean, we're doing this campaign literally to help jumpstart that, but we hope to encourage folks to continue this with us, and we're happy to help with resources or talent when we can.
I think Rod was looking at my card for the next question, because you were really providing such a great segue. So the next question is, of course, recognizing the severe cuts that have happened to school districts and how, unfortunately, they're being forced to reduce their social workers and their support staff down to the minimum legal requirements because of those constricting budgets. What do we do inside of that environment where the schools have such limited resources? How do we help lead to more resources? What resources are out there, and how can we really partner with schools in that environment?
I'm going to start with Cassie.
So one of the things that we offer at Oakland Mediation Center is the mediation service, and that is for free. So this is this fabulous orange brochure here, right? So this is a federally funded program, so it doesn't cost anything for the school or for the family to request a facilitator at a meeting or a mediation to address a specific issue. And, you know, people will come to mediation, let's say, because they're in disagreement over the services that are being offered. And so maybe one side is saying we need 3 days, and another side is saying no, you know, 1 day. And the beauty of the mediation process is that the mediator helps to identify with people what their interest is. You know, what is it about the 1 day that's important to you? What is it about the 3 days that's important to you? And it helps to facilitate a conversation so that people can think outside of the box and be really creative with solutions, so that they come up with a solution that might not be 1 or 3 days, that's completely different, but that meets people's needs still 100%. And that's really critical to be able to be creative and think outside of the box when we're trying to meet people's needs, because we can do so in a way that doesn't tax the limited resources that we have. I'm actually going to pass it.
She's being mindful of your time limitations and wanting to get to all the panelists.
And my limited experience, I'll be honest.
Yeah. So rephrase the question so I make sure I capture it.
So what suggestions do you have to help support our schools given the limited resources?
Yeah, and that, I mean, that's a tough one. Recognizing the fact that we all are interested in trying to improve educational outcomes, I think we have to be real about what the resource drain on certain schools is doing to the special education population. I mean, it's driven us to launch this campaign because we are seeing certain schools with larger percentages of students in special education, which adds a layer of complication to being able to serve them properly.
Specifically around the school to prison pipeline, so we hold a number of speakers each year. We have workshops, we publicize workshops. I think someone from the Michigan Alliance for Families is here. We publicized going to an IEP workshop, that sort of thing. So our goal is sort of letting these incoming students who will be the people in these professions for years to come get educated on what the issue is and how we're starting to address it.
So one of the ways that Oakland Mediation Center engages all of these people is when we do work in schools to implement a variety of different programs, one of the first things that we do is create a committee of people to come together to talk about how are they going to take this expertise that they're receiving from Oakland Mediation Center and combine that with the expertise that they have on their community. And so these committees consist of parents, community members, and school personnel. And when we have school people, we always want to make sure that we have administrators there, that we have teachers there, that we have people that are responsible for the discipline. So if there is like a school suspension officer, things like that, we have school resource officers, someone from that mental health background. So it's usually either the school social worker or school counselor. But we really pull together a diverse group of people because they all have a different perception that they bring to the table, different experiences with students. So we bring all of those people together for them to be able to talk about how are they going to tailor the program to fit the specific needs of that school.
So in the event that these cooperative activities don't create a positive result, or in situations where students are still being treated improperly under the law, that's sort of where I come in. And of course, first we try and work collaboratively again with the schools to try and get better results for our clients, for their students. If that is not successful, we will file complaints, due process complaints, and usually those end up settling before they go to hearing. School districts are usually pretty willing to come to agreements to keep out of the administrative hearing system. And usually those lead to positive results. I'm thinking of one case about a year ago where one of the terms of our settlement agreement was that all school resource officers would have a training where they would be educated on special ed rights, on how to read a behavior plan, how to implement a behavior plan, and what to look for when students are acting inappropriately. So, you know, although we try to resolve cases before we need to file complaints, sometimes it does get to that point, and it usually leads to positive results in the end.
All right, so I had already said that we were done with the cards and that we had run out of time, but since this was directed at just one person, so I think we can handle it pretty quickly. Kenzie, you are so popular tonight. So somebody had a question about what your organization offers as far as training for restorative practices, and if you have any data on the efficacy of that program.
So great question. Yes, we do offer training around restorative practices, and we offer...
We want to define what that is, because I forgot to define what that is. So if we could talk about what that is.
Yeah. So restorative practices can really be more of like an umbrella term. And so what it is there's a prevention side of things and there's an intervention kind of side of things. But this thought of restorative practices, it comes down to community building and having meaningful connections and relationships with people. So on the preventative side of things, so what we do is we teach educators how to utilize the circle process in their classrooms to build that sense of community and make connections with students. Some schools might have what they call morning meetings, some have circle times, you know, they're called a lot of different things, but the same concept is sitting down together and building those relationships and increasing empathy amongst everyone. It also, on the prevention side, is referring to simply how we communicate with each other. And so when we're communicating with people, acknowledging the emotion and the human nature behind situations. Also then on the intervention side of things, there's a lot of different processes that are used after a situation has happened that brings kind of the victim and the offender, for lack of better words, together to talk about what happened, who was impacted by it, and what needs to be done in order to repair that harm and kind of restore those relationships and restore that sense of balance. So there's victim offender mediation, there's circles, there's conferences, and they're all different processes with that same goal in mind. Our center specifically hasn't done a research project, going back to the funding issue. However, there has been research done in that area. On this brochure, we cite a statistic around 34% reduction in juvenile recidivism, and that number comes specifically from victim offender mediation used as a diversion program in juvenile court cases. But I know there are other organizations and institutions that have done a lot of research around that. There's IIRP, which is the International Institute on Restorative Practices. Also in the... I know. Don't want her after me, right? There is also the Minnesota Department of Education has done a lot with restorative practices and researching its effectiveness. Yes, and those are the two off the top of my head that are coming to mind, but there's a growing research base out there.
Okay, so let's thank our panelists if we could, please.
More communication. We need to really help educate folks. We did one of these in Lansing last month, and the same sorts of themes emerged. And it's good from the perspective that it lets us know there's really a need for this type of campaign. We have the resources to help address some of these. The challenge will be, you know, how can we get more of you to help us in that effort? Because it's really going to take the folks from the community, the parents, students, advocates, and educators as well, to be on board with this. So we'd like to make sure that we stress the fact that this is the first of what we hope are many of these types of conversations, and that we truly do get representatives of those various sectors involved. So I think educators have to be a part of this, as do students and parents and other concerned folks. Second thing is we have set up a portion of our website, aclumich.org/special-ed-resources. It's on the agendas that you all have as a sort of repository for special ed related information, including a PDF of the handout we brought today. And we can include our partners' information there and links to your sites. And I got to figure out a way to be able to continue to capture this information that we're gathering through these, because we hope to include those in policy recommendations we go forth to legislators with in the future. I'd also ask you to talk to your legislators about zero tolerance. You know, we are, once again, working on a bill to narrow the scope of zero tolerance back to weapons, realizing that there are exceptions already there, and that getting rid of some of those other things will cut down on suspensions and expulsions. And really, as I said before, begin to steer us away from a punitive approach or to correct them. And also reduce some of those disparities that have resulted in so many kids in special education being suspended. So with that, the final thing I have to say is make sure you take the materials here, and if you don't need them yourself, make sure you get them in the hands of someone who might be able to use them, and if you ever need more, you know, my card is on the table. You can grab one on your way out. Feel free to contact me about materials or about organizing more of these going forward. With that said, thank you again for coming out, and I'll turn it back over to you.